Hello and welcome to this video on mergers and takeovers.
So in this video we're going to look at why businesses grow and how they grow, the two types, organic and inorganic growth, and also look at some of the constraints on business growth. So why might companies want to grow? Well, a number of reasons. We're going to look at four here: to achieve economies of scale, increase market power, increase market share, and increased profitability. And we're going to look at some of these terms in turn.
Let's start off with economies of scale. Economies of scale arise when unit costs fall as output increases. So as we increase the scale of production, the average cost of producing each unit gets cheaper. So let's have a look at an example. In this scenario, we're going to assume fixed costs are £10,000, variable costs are £100 per unit. And if we have a look at how that would affect variable costs and fixed costs and therefore cost per unit, let's look at this table. So we can see on the left hand side, as output increases, fixed costs remain the same, variable costs would increase, total costs would increase, but look what's happening to the cost per unit. The cost per unit is going down as we increase the scale of production. So the cost of each unit, even though we're making more units, will decrease effectively because the fixed costs are spread over a large amount of units. So businesses may seek to achieve economies of scale through growth. Often this is presented to us as a cost curve. In this chart here, we can see average cost per unit on the y-axis and the quantity of output on the x-axis. And we can see the cost curve here showing the average cost is going down as we increase the quantity of output. Now, why would you want to achieve economies of scale? Well, lower unit costs, producing something at a lower average cost, is important in making a business more competitive because it allows a business to do one of two things: either reduce prices whilst keeping the same profit margin, or maintain the same price, but if your costs are lower per unit, you'd be earning more profit per unit on the product. Businesses often want to grow, but a key question they have to ask is how are they going to go about doing it? Broadly speaking, business has two options. The first is internal growth, which is where a business goes it alone and expands its own operations. A good example would be Apple, who've invested heavily in their own research and development. The alternative approach is external growth, and that's where a business expands by merging or taking over other businesses. And a good example of that would be someone like Google. And if you look at their history, they have acquired lots of other little businesses and incorporated them into their own. Organic growth, sometimes known as internal growth, occurs when a business expands in size by opening new stores, branches, functions, or plants. Effectively, it means the business is going alone and expanding its own operations. This can be time consuming, but it's a relatively low risk strategy because control is easier to maintain. How could a business grow without merging or taking over? Or perhaps by releasing new products, extending the product range, or widening the target market. Maybe targeting new markets, opening new outlets across existing markets, or expanding into other countries. A third approach would be developing new routes to markets, changing the channels of distribution, perhaps adopting an e-commerce approach, or maybe using retailers, or perhaps wholesalers, depending on what they do. Maybe increasing the type and location of stores. The fourth approach might be franchising, changing the business model to allow for quicker growth through franchises. And lastly, diversification, selling new products in new markets. On the other hand, inorganic growth, sometimes known as external growth, occurs when a business expands in size by either merging with or taking over another business. It can allow businesses to expand more quickly, as it's buying businesses that are already established, but it can be high risk if the two businesses are not compatible and the deal doesn't work out. Let's start off, what is a merger? A merger is when two or more businesses agree to become integrated, joined, to form one business under joint ownership. So it's really an agreement between A and B to become the business AB. An example would be the agreement between Iberia and British Airways to merge and become international airlines group. So it's not one buying the other, it's an integration of the two to form one under joint ownership. A takeover is when one business gains control over another business and becomes the owner. And that can be achieved by buying 51% of the shares, and sometimes can be known as a hostile takeover, which is when the smaller company, perhaps the management of that company, doesn't want to be bought by the company doing the takeover. An example might be when Kraft bought Cadbury, even though a lot of the workers and some of the managers at Cadbury didn't want Kraft to buy the shares. The first one we're going to look at is a horizontal merger or takeover, and that is when both businesses are at the same stage within a process. An example would be when Orange and T-Mobile and EE all merged together under the EE name. Those businesses all were part of the same process. They're both all mobile phone service operators, and that would be a horizontal. Another example would be ExxonMobil. When those two businesses joined, Exxon and Mobil, both companies that sold petrol, same stage of the process, the production process, so that would be horizontal. Vertical mergers or takeovers are where the two businesses are at different stages of the process and they integrate. Now this comes in two further types. A forward vertical is when a business joins together with another business at the next stage in the process, nearer the customer. So a manufacturer perhaps with a retailer. A backwards vertical merger or takeover is when a business joins with another business at an earlier stage in the production process. So a manufacturer maybe is taken over or merges with a supplier of a raw material. For example, a forward vertical merger would be if a steel plant took over a car manufacturing company. That would be forward vertical. They're at different stages of the process of car manufacturing. But this one, the steel plant taking over the Ford manufacturer, the car manufacturer, will be getting nearer to the customer, forward. An example of a backward vertical merger would be, for example, if a tour operator took over an airline company. So they're getting further away from people who book the holidays and actually moving towards a supplier who provides the service. That would be backward, getting further away from the customer. Let's have a quick summary of horizontal, vertical, forward and backward. Let's imagine we're in the position of Ford, the car manufacturer. Now if Ford took over Vauxhall, we would call that horizontal integration. They are both at the same stage in the production process of cars. They both take raw materials and turn them into cars and then sell those cars onto showrooms. They're both at the same stage, so that would be horizontal. They do the same business. Now, if Ford were to buy a supplier of tires like Dunlop, that would be vertical, and we're getting further away from the customer. Here is a raw material supplier or a supplier of tyres, getting further away from the customer, so that would be a backward vertical takeover. If Ford, however, bought a business like Arnold Clark Motor Store that has a load of car showrooms, then that is getting closer to the customer. The showroom is where the customer goes, so that would be forward vertical takeover. It might be worth at this stage taking some good notes on these topics if you need to. Finally, conglomerate. A conglomerate is where two unrelated businesses integrate, so they're not associated with the same production process. An example may be when Virgin Money took over Northern Rock and integrated that into the Virgin Group. Those businesses, the business within the Virgin Group and Northern Rock, were unrelated prior to that. A joint venture is where a business has an arrangement with another business to pool their resources for the purpose of accomplishing a specific task. So the task can be a new project, perhaps another business activity. Examples would be when BP, the oil company, created a new company with the Russian oil company TNK, called BP TNK, and together they had a specific project to set up oil and gas mining in a particular region. Another example would be Sony Ericsson. That was originally a joint venture between Sony, a separate business, and Ericsson, a separate business. They created a joint venture, pooled their resources in this new entity to research into mobile phone handsets. Okay, so why might a business want to grow externally by acquiring other businesses? Well, a comment you'll often hear is because of synergies. And the idea behind a synergy is that the two firms joined together will be able to achieve more than the sum of the two firms operating separately. So the idea, very simply, if you had a business that was making £2 million of profit and you merge it with another business that makes £2 million of profit, if it's a good fit, then the combined business might make £5 million worth of profit as a result of synergies, the combined sum of the business being greater than the two businesses individually. Secondly, the larger combined business might have better negotiating terms with suppliers. They might be able to secure outlets for customers or have a wider range of outlets for customers. They might benefit from sharing distribution networks, enabling them to get their products around further or maybe at a lower cost. It will enable them to gain a stronger foothold in the market, greater market share, and the advantages that come with that. The companies might benefit from each other's expertise. A lot of technology companies acquire small companies with particular expertise in a certain area and then incorporate that into their business. Again, companies might buy smaller other companies if they've got a particularly good idea or if they've got particularly good technology that they want to use. A larger business might have stronger brand recognition. And finally, it may be a way of achieving the corporate objectives of the business, greater market share or greater profit or whatever it might be. Let's start off by looking at some of the risks. Well, when two businesses come together, either through a merger or a takeover, and they're already quite large, often the government will intervene to assess whether there's going to be any problems with competition for customers. Effectively, if they think the two businesses together are going to rip customers off, then the government may stop it. So there's a risk that a regulator or the government might get involved. For example, when Asda bought some stores from Netto, or merged with Netto, the government forced Asda to sell off some of those stores as a part of that procedure. The second risk is the cost of integrating the new businesses together. So there might be a change in culture, there might be new training required, you might need to relocate staff, or you might need to make people redundant. For example, when Paddy Power merged with Betfair, there were a number of redundancies, and that would have been a cost to the business to pay those people off and also to reorganize. Thirdly, if a business has taken over another business, how have they done it? Have they used retained profit? Have they used equity? Or have they perhaps used debt? And if they've used debt, there might be a cost of financing the takeover that they're going to have to pay in the future. Fourthly, a lot of businesses do lots of research prior to acquiring another business, and there is a cost to that research. Lastly, what's the impact on share value? If investors and shareholders don't think it's a good idea, and they don't think it's been very well done, then there may be an impact on the value of the business. On the plus side, what are the rewards from merging or taking over or growing externally? Well, first of all, potential for greater revenues. Secondly, great potential for economies of scale. Thirdly, increased market share and potentially profit.
So we've looked at why and how businesses grow, organic and inorganic growth, and mergers and takeovers. Let's now look at some of the constraints on business growth. So what might be a limit or prevent businesses growing so quickly, or what might be reasons why we might say they've grown too fast and it's a potential risk? First one is overtrading. This occurs when a business grows so quickly that it spends so much money on buying increased stock in order to sell more of it that actually it jeopardizes the cash flow position of the business and they have a risk of running out of money. Sometimes there can be cultural clashes as a result of mergers or takeovers that mean that it's unsuccessful and the growth doesn't work. Taking on large amounts of debt jeopardizes the business, or not being able to borrow, lack of finance might be a risk in terms of a constraint on growth. You might not be able to grow very quickly if you can't borrow from a bank. Conflicting messages to customers and other stakeholders about trying to change the business and trying to grow it might mean it's not effective at growing. Likewise, uncertainty within the workforce, poor strategic decision making by management, not having the resources within the business to enable the company to grow. So maybe we just have one machine, and actually with that one machine, we can't grow the business any further. And diseconomies of scale, when average unit costs start to rise as we increase the scale of production. So in this video, we've looked at why and how businesses grow, and just then we looked at some of the constraints, reasons why businesses can't grow, or limits to their growth. That's it. Adios. Thank you for listening.